Good morning and happy Sabbath.
Good morning and happy Sabbath.
It's a great honor and privilege for me to stay here in front of you and in front of the, in the presence of the holy angels and the Holy Spirit, who is taking a precise record of everything what is going on, happen here. And also the Holy Spirit is the one who helps us to understand the scripture. All these singers, the speakers who do what they do, they just reflect, they present the message. But to digest, it's not the job of the speaker or the preacher to do it. It's the job of the Holy Spirit. So let's pray for the Holy Spirit to be really part of this event and teach us the way how God wants us to do it. I am really pleased to be here today because there's many things happened during this week, and we cannot say that was unnoticed or pretend that nothing happened. It was a tremendous event happens during this week in this country, and specifically in the area where we're living. If someone who lives in California or some other place, they didn't feel it much, we did, because the roads were closed, we had a lot of traffic here, and there are many changes. But one thing what I've learned for myself, I've been listening some of the interviews, and I was impressed about the interview that Bob Fisher on CBS gave on the news about outcoming President Barack Obama. And I'm really related to the gospel, to the Jesus Christ who did it so much. I'm not saying that Barack Obama is the one who can compare with, but he kind of prototype. And one thing, I wanted to read this for you. And in his commentary, he said, talks about look back at the Barack Obama's years. After that, African American grandmothers could finally say to their grandsons and granddaughters that my granny said to me, he said, "See, one day you could be a president too." Until Barack Obama, there was no proof of that. And I completely agree with him. Brethren, until Jesus Christ was no proof for that. But from that time and on, we have proof that God approved his sacrifice, and by following his footsteps, we could do just the same thing. And I'm not, like I said, I'm not only giving credit to people, but they deserve some credit for things they, what they have done. Today, I would like us to begin our new series of study, the book of Romans. Book of Romans, which was written by Apostle Paul, previously known as Saul. He was not the best, actually he was best of the best in what he was doing. He was very zealous Pharisees, he was very educated, we'll talk more about that. He was very influential man in his time. And he had a great impact on the whole civilized society until this day. There are 27 epistles or books in the New Testament, and 14 of them he is the author. He wrote those 14. And as I said, he was very influential man. He was the one who was watching Stephen when he was stoned in Acts 7:58. You can find that one. In Acts 12:22-20, he gave a testimony about that. He says, "I also was standing by and consenting unto his death, and kept the raiment of them that slew him." The Paul was zealous to persecute Christians. In Acts chapter 9, verses 1 and 2, we have this record. It says that he was breathing out threatening and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest and grabbed the letters and went to Damascus to arrest some other people. All of that was in his life until he met Jesus. In the same chapter 9 of Acts of Apostles, we have this record, verse 5. And he said, when Jesus met him, there was a light shining from heaven, and he fell down on the ground, and Saul had this dialogue. And the question was, "Who art thou, Lord?" And the Lord said, I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. In verse 6, chapter 9. And he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what will thou have me to do? The best question what I ever heard, ever read, I learned from myself. When we address or appeal or call to God and say, Lord, what do you want me to do now? Not someday, not another year, next year, now. Following the life of apostles, once he was converted, he used the same energy, had the same energy, just redirect in different direction. In verse chapter 20, verse 24 of Acts of Apostles, he had a meeting with his fellow brethren on island of Melit. But none of these things move me, neither count I myself life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy, and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. That was his life, not just life periodically, sometimes lifestyle, daily routine, I would say. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1, he makes this statement, Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preach unto you, which also ye have received and wherein ye stand. Realizing his brokenness, and he was hoping on grace, and he was living that gospel what he was preaching. He was breathing gospel, reflecting in his life. And continue on, verse 7, chapter 15, 1 Corinthians. After that, he was seen on James, when of all the apostles, and last of all, he was seen unto me as one of one born of due time. Verse 9, for I am the least of the apostles that am not meet to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain. Such a wonderful statement he made. He describes his conversion. He said, I am the chief of sinner. He was never ashamed or hiding his background on that sense. But he said, but now I am a new creature. I'm somebody else. I am not the same Paul or Saul as I used to be. Gospel to Romans, I call this way gospel, because it is a lot of gospel in it, because it presents Christ as a savior, and who are willing to not just share, to impute his righteousness to anyone who believes in him. Epistle to Romans have changed many prominent lives. One of them was Martin Luther. He was looking for God. Once he, remember, those who read his biography, after that terrible event, he made a pledge, he promised to serve God. And he kept his promise. He became a Catholic. He went to seminary against his father's will. And he was very devoted one. He did even more than he was asked for. And but he couldn't find peace in his heart. He couldn't find God in all those ritual ceremonies, until one old man advised him to read the Bible. And he was changed by that. He was changed and come across that Bible verse that we read today, that just shall live by faith, nothing else. For some reason, some of us have this impression that gospel is only for sinners. Those who are outside this room, who are walking on the street on Sabbath, who are going to work and doing all the foolish things, at least what is not godly to do on Sabbath, gospel is for them and not for us, because we already are here on this side of the room. Is it so? Gospel has to be present every single day, every single moment of our life, and transforming us, bringing us, uplifting us, and making us different. I wanted to emphasize again and again how much heaven have done for us. And little things what we're observing in this world kind of bring us back to Christ, back to Jesus. I read in the news last week that in Japan, I cannot pronounce that name, in Hokkaido Island, there's a train station. And that train station, the train stops only twice a day. People are moved out and normally shouldn't, but because of one student, one girl, which is attending high school in neighbor town, the train, the whole train, big one, stops just for her, to pick her up, to take her to school, and to bring her back home. Isn't that wonderful? And I've read that many people in the feedback, they praise the government of Japan, how much they care for people. And I was thinking how much Lord keeps taking care for us. They just noticed that government keeps spending money for one single person. And they say that she's going to be graduating March 26, and then the train stop. I mean, they never stop there. They will just go through. So, point is, heaven have done much more than Japanese government for us. We've studied right now in our Sabbath school that heaven give the best gift whatever heaven has, his the Son, Jesus Christ. I have this statement from Selected Message Book 1, page 245, paragraph 1. God has not made the reception of the gospel to depend upon human reasoning. The gospel is adopted for spiritual food, to satisfy man's spiritual appetite. In every case, it is just what man needs. Don't try to make it complicated. We try to make it complicated. We're living in a very complicated world. Even our cell phones become so complicated. Without special skills, you don't know how to navigate. If you grab another one, different brand, you're lost. So, Satan is trying to impress us or convince us the gospel belongs only to very few, to elected one. Not everybody can understand it. It's too complicated. You have to have a too long study, much degrees to understand that in order to be yours, which is completely wrong, completely wrong. Jesus Christ was preaching simple gospel. Even children could understand him. So do we. We don't have to preach complicated subject that people get lost on the way. So it might seem that we are not preaching Adventist message today, but it is, because gospel is our base, our foundation. If you miss this one, you cannot go any further. Continue reading from same book, second paragraph, Select Message Book 1, page 245, paragraph 2. The gospel is the power of God and the wisdom of God. The character of Christ on earth revealed divinity. And the gospel which he has given is to be the study of his human heritage. In all their educational departments, until teachers, children, and youth shall discern in the only true and living God, the object of their faith and love and adoration. We are granted the privilege of school life in this world that we may obtain a fitness for the higher life, the highest grade in the highest school, where under God our studies will continue through the ceaseless ages of eternity. Wow. We say, oh, I'm graduate, I'm done with this, I'm get my degree, I don't have to go to school. Not in this case. In the case of our spiritual studies, we are never graduate. Because every time when you open the same book, maybe that you read a while ago, it's some new horizons are open or reflected to you. Paul reflects the gospel. He defines and maybe different way than people used to understand at that time. Let's just go over the book of Romans, just give you a brief outline. What is this book about, since we're going to stay in this book for quite a bit? Paul present to this book to devoted Jewish in Rome, basics of the gospel. And the book of Acts, in the very first chapters, we find out that when at the day of Pentecost, there was a devoted Jews from different countries, surrounding countries, from Rome as well. There was a Roman Empire, by the way. They didn't speak much Hebrew anymore. That's why God gave them ability to speak different languages. And once they get back to Rome, they organize a church. The Paul never had a chance to be there yet. And by the way, the book of Romans was written in Corinth, the city of Corinth. And he was eager to see them. He had a desire to see them. But so far, they heard about him. And he decided to write them a book, epistle. What is about? Chapter 1, I just give you a brief outline of that for you to have a kind of taste of it and have kind of like appetizer for future studies. Chapter 1 describes why do we need the gospel. This is a problem for many Christians, that we believe the gospel is only for sinners, not for righteous one. Chapter 2, about incapability of religion to bring peace with God. All your rituals or your traditions cannot substitute Christ himself in your heart. That's chapter 2. Chapter 3, presentation of gospel. He breaks down in details what is the gospel in chapter 3. In chapter 4, gospel in the Old Testament, he's talking about David and Abraham. He said that it was a grace then as well as it is now. And they were saved by faith as we are today. He's trying to convince his listeners in the same doctrine. God never changed. Chapter number 5, result of gospel, outcome of those who are born of Christ, like changes will happen in the life of the one who accept the gospel. Chapter 6, examination. Can we become a Christian and continue to do what we want or we used to do it? Kind of he's debating on that. Once you become a Christian, should you stay in the same way or how that change takes place in your heart? In chapter 7, he wrestling or fighting with sin. He said, how we really can overcome sin. Chapter 8, he talks about the comfort of the gospel or in the gospel, hope and strength the gospel gives to any devoted Christian. Chapter 9, from chapter 9 through 11, he talks about the Israel and the gospel, how gospel applied to Israel and physical and spiritual one. It's an interesting chapters to study as well. And from chapter 12 through 15, gospel in practical life. The gospel is the transformation of relationship. That's those rest of the chapter from 12 to 15. I really encourage you to take your notes and be on the top, and you will be much, much benefit or blessed once you understand the way how it was presented to a book of Romans. Let's go to book of Romans, chapter 1, verse 1. Let's start from the beginning. Romans, chapter 1, verse 1. Romans 1, 1. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God. How does Paul introduce himself here? Another translation, bond servant of Jesus Christ. He does not introduce himself as a man with a good education, with a good background. All of that he dropped. All those titles, what he have had, he left behind. All what he said, I am servant. I am a slave. Do you know that you are a slave no matter what?
Yes.
You're a slave of Christ or a slave of Satan. You're serving. You're a servant. So he said, I used to be a slave to someone else, but now I am proud that I'm blessed that I'm servant of Jesus Christ. It's a good introduction. Actually, Paul is very good in salutation. And this goes all the way to verse 7. He was speaking about himself, introducing himself. I ask myself, I want you to ask yourself a question. How are you introducing yourself? What are you saying about yourself? Wow. I am so-and-so. I am father of so. I am have this position. I have this title, this degree. I have so many things. I'm living in this house. What are you saying about yourself when you're introducing yourself? What is the first one that comes to your mind? Are you ever introduce yourself? Look, no. I am, and I am a Christian, and I belong to this church, and I believe in this, this, and this. That's what Paul did. Would be good if we can adopt or accept this kind of introduction to us. I was watching on YouTube some of the video clips, and I like that. And on the end of that presentation, the lady says, I am a mom and I am a Mormon. Which is kind of not related, but she didn't leave behind those important things. She says, and I am a Mormon. Are we saying, are we using it? If we didn't do it till now, it's good to learn it. It's good to learn it and introduce ourselves the way how Paul did it. What else did he say? Okay, we make clear, he introduced himself as a servant. And also he says, called to be an apostle. What is apostle? What is the apostle? What's the meaning of the word apostle? Messenger. He said, I was called. I am a servant. And after I was called to be an apostle, are we not called to be a messengers here? I believe that's fitting in our, I would say lifestyle, our calls as well. We can say you are called to be a messenger. You are called to be an apostle. Not necessarily to be a minister or elder, but you are messengers. We all are messengers. The one who was baptized in Jesus Christ, he is baptized as a missionary, okay? And he's talking about his vocation. In Paul's mind, to be an apostle was to be a person who had seen Jesus Christ risen from the dead so that he could give first-hand testimony. And I don't believe as well any of us can give a good testimony without having that experience with the Lord. We're going to be pretending. We're going to be making up stories, trying to convince. But if you don't have it here, if you never went through it, no experience, thank you. No experience, how can you share it? Remember that Bible verse, I believe Psalm 45, taste and see how good is God. And I said it before, if I'll explain you theoretically how good this Russian borscht is, and you might believe me somehow, but that would be not that convincing until you try it for yourself. Okay? You can preach as many as you want, but if your life is not matching what you're preaching, worthless. Worthless. There's very little chances that you're going to be, that you would convince anybody around you. Okay, that was part number two. Number three, separate unto the gospel of God. See, he is not leaving behind anything of that. He said, I was separated myself for what? For gospel. What is gospel? Good news, okay? The gospel is that someone paid the price that you can enjoy for in the future, okay? That is the gospel. The gospel is that all of us, we have a hope that we are not living this life in vain, that we have some kind of, like also Apostle says, the Jeremiah, expect that end. Okay? God is not keeping us in limbo and go and I don't know how it's going to come out, what's going to come out of this. No, He wants us to go in specific direction and do the specific work and leave the result for Him to solve it. Okay? Let's just summarize what He says. Separate unto the gospel of God. My dear brethren, if you are not separated, if I am not separated, all my intention, all my efforts are worthless. If I am trying to serve two masters, what happened? And you're right. And you are very right. I believe we have this in on the back of your bulletin, the short paragraph. The gospel of the grace of God, with its spirit of self-abnegation, can never be in harmony with the spirit of the world. Do you see what I see? Do you read what I read? The two principles are antagonistic. The natural man receiveth not the thing of the spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. So, going back to Paul, Paul said, I separated myself for the gospel of God. If you overlook this verse just one, you'll find very interesting thought here. It looks like Paul talking about himself, but in reality he is talking about God, who is behind and over all of this, what he is doing. He is not taking anything, any credit to himself. He says, Paul, servant of Jesus, called to be apostle for somebody, separated for the gospel. Everything what he's trying to talk for about himself, he always redirecting the credit to someone else. In reality, this verse number one is not about Paul, but about God. It's very unique, very, very interesting. I found this study very fascinating, and I really believe that we will be blessed, and there would be not just benefit, there would be change in our life after we go through this study. Paul, he had a very unique background, as I mentioned a little bit earlier. In Philippians chapter 3, this is my favorite chapter, by the way, from, it's not only one, this is one of it. Chapter 3, verse 4, Philippians chapter 3, verse 4. Though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if any other man thinking that he had whereof, he might trust in the flesh, I more. In other words, he's saying, look, if any one of you can boast about your achievement, about your background, I'm going to beat you there. I'm the best one. I am the best. And he gives his list of achievement. Circumcised the 8th day. That was the law of Moses, no? Of the stock of Israel, definitely. Of the tribe of Benjamin. And Hebrew of the Hebrews. As touching the law of Pharisees. You know, the Pharisees, they were very, I would say they were elite of a theologians in that time. And he was part of it. He knew his Torah, whatever he was teaching, very well. But just the wrong way. And continue on reading about Paul concerning zeal, persecuting the church, touching the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. Was he ever feel guilt about what he was doing? Never. He was doing his best to the best of his ability, how he understood until that time. And verse 7. But when things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. People are proud for their status, for different things. For example, this maybe sounds weird. They make some weird haircut and they're proud of that. They dye their hair with blue, white, whatever, they're proud of that. They belong to some club, they're proud of that. They have a different sexual orientation, they're proud of that. I'm not saying that there should be things that you should be happy with, but should be noble one. For example, to have a good education, be a good citizen, be a good father. Yes, definitely, you can be kind of satisfied with what you achieve. But people are proud with some weird things today. Have you noticed what I did? That is wrong. But what Paul says here, but what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Paul was a giant. He had a lot of achievements. How about you? Did you come in your life, in spiritual life, to that point as Paul did to make the same statement? Verse 7, I'm referring to this one. But what things were gained to me, those I count loss for Christ. Are you willing, my dear brother and sister, those who listen to us, to sacrifice, to give up everything for the sake of gospel? Or are we still holding something for ourselves? Just in case. Just in case. All our achievements equals zero without understanding the gospel. He was very happy to introduce himself and his status as a slave of Jesus Christ. Gospel is a power. That's what we read in first chapter, verse 16. Gospel is a power for salvation. Paul, through all his life, he was a messenger since that day when Jesus met him and he was converted. Verse 8, continue on reading the same chapter, Philippians 3, chapter 3, verse 8. Ye doubtless and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ. He's using kind of not nice words, no? But that's what he's comparing with his previous life. And be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death. I have this statement from Christ Object Lessons, page 46. As soon as divine word comes to our heart, God desires us to receive it. No way, not to postpone, someday. And it is right to accept it with joy. Joy shall be in souls that believes on Christ. But those who in the parable are said to receive the world immediately do not count the cost. Talking about the parable about the sower and the seed, the one seed fell on the rocky soil. Those who receive immediately, they do not count the cost. Remember, we had recently, not that long ago, a study about the cost, count the cost, how much it costs. Are you willing to pay the price to join? They do not consider what the word of God requires of them. They do not bring it face to face with all their habits of life and yield themselves fully to its control. Emotionally, people are attracted to it. Many people are following Jesus. Do you know that? Many. He fed 5,000, less or more. All the time, the crowd of people were following. How many left? Few. I'm not exaggerating. Book Evangelism, page 355. Why some new believers do not advance? That's a good question, not only for new, for old one as well. Humble, simple-hearted, trusting souls may do a work which will cause rejoicing in the heart among the angels of God. Simple work. If you do, you make angels happy. Their work at home, in their neighborhood, and in the church will be in its result as fear-reaching, far-reaching as eternity. You say, oh, that's, who cares about that? Just little things. Oh, yes, heaven does. As far-reaching as eternity. It is because this work is not done that the experience of young converts never reach beyond the ABC in divine things. They are always babes, always needing to be fed upon meal and never able to partake of true gospel meat. We had this study as well, remember, last year, I believe, or before last. What is your spiritual age? Are you babe? Are you child? Are you teenager? Or you are grown up? Gospel was not a reaction of God to sin or what happened in Garden of Eden. Gospel is not a reaction. 1 Peter chapter 1:18. For as much as ye know that ye were not redeemed with corruptible things and a silver and gold from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of the Lamb without blemish and without spot. Verse 20, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifested in the last times for you. Gospel was not the reaction. The gospel was, the foundation was built way before man fall in sin even. The gospel has a great power, and as we have studying about this, Genesis chapter 3, can we find the gospel in the Old Testament? Yes. Genesis 3:15. And I will put an enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed, and shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise her heel. Listen here, I want you to hear this. When man was able to tempt Adam and Eve, and they fall in sin, the man become one with Satan. In other words, the man took a side of Satan. And both they became rebelling against God. Both, Satan and man. But during all ages, God was revealing gospel to them. And it says that, according to Genesis 3:15, it says, I'll put enmity between thee and the woman, between the seed and her seed, thy seed and her seed. The God was teaching them that from the woman, from the human race, there would be someone who would change the routine of that. It was talking about Jesus Christ. The gospel was through all Old Testament. During all ages, God was revealing gospel to them. Israel, when Israel was built as a nation, they grew in slavery. You know that. They become as a nation in slavery. They've been enslaved even before they become a nation. Yeah, the one family moved in, but on the end, when they grew, they multiply, they become a slave. They began their existence as a slave. So do you. So do I. We begin our existence. I want you to see this analogy. You are born as a slave of this world. So does Israelites. Before they were liberated, they were slaves. And what happened first thing before that liberation? Exodus chapter 12. The Lord will, the Moses told them what to do, take a lamp and make a special preparation and do certain way. And I kind of omit those things. Hopefully that you know them. And just go to verse 23 immediately. But if you want, you can read the whole chapter 12 of Exodus. For the Lord will pass through to smite the Egyptians. And when he seeth the blood of the lintel, upon the lintel and on the two sides posts, the Lord will pass over the door. Do you know where the Passover derived from? The word is right here. Two words. Pass over. Today people don't think much about, they just use it as a one word, like, you know, define some events. But in reality, it was a two words. Will pass over the door. That's what the Bible says. And will not suffer the destroyer to come into your houses to smite you. Verse 23, I just read. Continue reading. And ye shall observe these things for an ordinance to thee and to thy sons forever. And it shall come to pass when he come to the land which the Lord will give you according as he had promised, that ye shall keep this service. We will talk this afternoon about the another Passover, another liberation. We're going to talk about communion when Jesus established new covenant, new event. But let's just finish with this one for now. What happened when you come to the new land? And shall come to pass when your children shall say unto you, what mean ye by this service? Verse 27. That ye shall say, it is the sacrifice of the Lord's Passover, who passed over the house of the children of Israel in Egypt, when he smote the Egyptians and delivered our houses. And the people bow the head and worship. How nice. It's a gospel by itself. Someone was sacrificed to save another. So, gospel was constantly present in the time of Israel. They had this type of gospel. The lamb was sacrificed every Passover to remind them that they were liberated and how they were liberated. So, keeping afresh in our memories the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, no less important, even more, because our life is on stake. For even Christ, our Passover, 1 Corinthians 5:7, purge out therefore the old leaven, that ye may be a new lump, as ye are unleavened. For even Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Israel, the people of Israel, is a demonstration of sinful life. They have personal presence of God among them, are they? Did they? They have their own land. They have the best law in the world. They have a lot of blessing which God specifically bestowed upon them. Nevertheless, their life was always full of rebellion, murmuring, and they were not happy with what they have had there. People of Israel didn't want to humble themselves. I'm not talking about Israel at that time. I'm talking about us. Are you receiving less than Israelites today? Having roof above your head? Having health? Food on the table? Peace? Not war zone around you? We are so much blessed. You have free access to the Word of God. You have everything what you need for spiritual growth. And what do you do with that? What are we doing with that? Are we grabbing and thirsty and hungry as Apostle Paul did when he met Jesus? Or are we saying, yeah, sounds good, looks good, Yeah, very impressive. Brethren, one more thing to share with you. The gospel which you learn today, it shouldn't be, oh, that would be good for my mother-in-law, for my neighbor, or for my co-worker. The gospel is for you. It's for you first. Because if you are not convinced with it, if your life is not reflecting it, then what's the point? What's the point? God says about these people, they have a lip service only. Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 33-31. God continues speaking about this issue. Behold, the days come, said the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. The gospel was even in the prophecy. The gospel was in the prophecy. Verse 32. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in that day. In the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was an husband unto them, said the Lord. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, said the Lord, I will put my law in their inward part. And write it in their hearts, and will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wow. Such a great prophecy. Verse 34, and they shall teach no more even man his neighbor, and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, for the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. That was the prophecy about new covenant. God wants to make a new covenant today with us. And those who made a covenant with the Lord by baptism, this is one step. But you should keep that covenant and refresh every single day of your life. We don't have that much time, but Isaiah 53, it talks about verse 4, it says, surely he had borne our griefs and carried our sorrow, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. Yet, verse 10, it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He had put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. That I would recommend you read all Isaiah 53. Ellen G. White, she suggesting us to read quite often this, to know about suffering of Jesus Christ. I would speak about this morning, afternoon, but now I just wanted to say that Isaiah 53 is not just to, not for to feel, to make you guilty, to feel guilty. It to show you the opportunity that heaven give it to you and grab it and stay upon it and move up. A few more things to share, before we wrap up. Jeremiah 34:40, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them that I will not turn away from them to do them good, but I will put my fear in their heart that they shall not depart from me. That was Jeremiah 32:40. And also those who take notes, you can take a note also, Ezekiel 36:26, a new heart also I will give you, a new spirit I'll put within you. And that was Ezekiel 36:26 and 27. Let's go back to Romans, book of Romans, and as we start, it looks like just few verses, but they have so much in it. We've learned the Apostle Paul introducing himself, and he was talking in verse 2, which he had promised afar by his prophets in the Holy Scripture. We just read about that. Verse 3, concerning his son Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh. It's a very interesting statement here as well. Number one, verse 4, I'll read verse 4. And declared to be the Son of God with the power according to the Spirit of holiness by this resurrection from the dead. 2 points. Number one, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh. Okay, Jesus Christ came by the prophecy from the seed of David. Number two, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness. See, by the seed of David and power, the spiritual part according to the Spirit of holiness. That Jesus was combining two things together. Does not exist to be a little bit of Christians. There is only two groups: those who accept Christ Jesus and those who are not. That's it. There's nothing less than that. We cannot earn salvation. I believe you have this in your bulletin, on the back of your bulletin. Let's start with the top. The gospel of Christ is a blessing that all may possess. The poorest are as well able as the richest to purchase salvation. For no amount of worldly wealth can secure it. It is obtained by willing obedience, by giving ourselves to Christ as his own purchased possession. Education, even on the highest class, cannot of itself bring a man near to God. The Pharisees were favored with every temporal and every spiritual advantage, and they said with the boastful pride, "We are rich and increased with good, and have need of nothing." Yet they were wretched, miserable, and poor, and blind, and naked. Revelation 3:17. We cannot earn salvation, but we are to seek for it, which as much as interest and perseverance as though we would abandon everything in the world for it. Next one. There are some who seem to be always seeking for a heavenly pearl, but they do not make an entire surrender of their wrong habits. They do not die to itself that Christ may live in them. Therefore, they do not find the precious pearl. They have not overcome unholy ambition and their love for worldly attractions. They do not take up the cross and follow Christ in the path of self-denial and sacrifice. Almost Christians, yet not fully Christians. They seem near the kingdom of heaven, but they cannot enter there. Almost, but not wholly saved, means to be not almost, but wholly lost. My dear brothers and sisters, children, those who are able to hear today, Apostle Paul is a great example. But if you learn from his writings, he never praised himself. He never focused attention on himself. No matter what he writes, he always pointing to Jesus, the one who brought him to that point. So this is a good pattern in our life, that coming out of this room, we will dedicate our life completely without any reserve and realize the time is running out. The presidents are maybe changed. They may have different programs. But the God set up the king, he takes them down. If he brought this one, there is a for a reason. There is no need for a protest. We're not encouraging our people to go and protest. That's foolishness. Once we protest, we show that we are not trusting in the Lord's guidance, even in this matter. God brought this person for a reason. Let's just be faithful in our duties, and God will bring us more. Amen.